This program is made possible by the loyal financial support of the friends and partners of Family Policy Institute.
Good evening and welcome to Watchmen on the Wall. Thank you for joining us. Tonight I'm speaking to ex-admin Louis Wilsenach, but now who has a burning passion for the new South Africa and in particular the Rainbow Nation of South Africa. Louis, welcome to the program. It's good to speak to you.
It's wonderful to be here on the wall with you.
On the wall.
On the Watchmen wall. On the wall. Yeah, I'm a Watchman.
Good to have you, Louis. You have a fascinating history background. And as I said in the intro, you have a background in advertising. You ran an advertising agency with some of the most prominent businesses in South Africa.
Absolutely.
You were involved in the political sphere, a pre-democracy, in which you met with P.W. Botha and then later with F.W. de Klerk. He says that you're responsible for this term, New South Africa. We see that in your book. But now God has given you a burning passion to restore South Africa, to bring South Africa into its full potential. And you believe that we are struggling as a nation. We're not where we're supposed to be. We're facing all kinds of challenges. But you said to me earlier that God has a definite plan and destiny for the nation of South Africa, and that God is giving you a burning desire to see that come to pass. But before we get to that, just give us a rundown of your past, your involvement with the National Party leading up to democracy.
Okay. Well, this story has never been told on television in South Africa. It's been told in television and in Europe, but never here. And I've actually kept it back for specific reasons, because if you don't speak into the Kairos time of God, you actually speak out of tune with Him, and you're out of step with Him, and nothing happens. As a young advertising guy, and advertising guys are quite crazy, hippies and what have you, we phone each other and we do all kinds of strange things with each other. We play the fool a lot of times. I had a call from this guy who called himself Dr. Kurnoff. Now, if you remember, Dr. Kurnoff had a distinct way of talking. It was very easy to imitate. It's like Madiba. You know, Madiba has a very easy way to copy him. So this guy phoned me and he said, he's Dr. Kurnoff. So I thought, you know, if he's Dr. Kurnoff, I'm Jesus. So, hello, Dr. Kurnoff, I'm Jesus. How can I help you? And the more he spoke to me, the more it became clear to me that he was actually Dr. Kurnoff. And I must stop playing the fool sooner or later. So I said, Dr. Kurnoff, thank you for calling me, but why do you call? And he said, well, the National Party has got a particular problem, and we were asking around, and we hear that you're a very bright young advertising guy. Can you come and advise us? And that's where the story starts. Now, it's amazing, and it starts on a jokey kind of a way. Anyway, from there, what happened is they wanted to involve the English voter also. They didn't want to just go with the Afrikaans vote. They felt that they must go into a new era. And they briefed me. They said, can you revive our party into, you know, a more modern party? I said, you know, I was a young admin, and it's fantastic to meet ministers and prime ministers and presidents. And so I did. So I did my first communication program for them. The first thing I threw out was their old logo. I don't know whether you remember the old National Party logo. It was a kruitdoring. You know what a kruitdoring is? Mm. Something you put gunpowder in, like the horn of a cow with gunpowder in. I threw that out and I made the NP with the two arrows, remember? Mm. And the slogan was forward together. At least now the English and Afrikaans people can vote together and become something. Alway loved it. And I remember presenting it to the then president, who was Foster, a long time ago. Eh? And it was distributed all over the president's house. All the chairs were at my campaign on it. And they said they love it. Let's go with it. And as I walked out of the room, out of the Libertas, I said to Dr. Kurnoff, by the way, I'm glad you like it, but it's going to cost 32,000 rand. He said, you don't understand. If you work with the National Party, the government, you don't talk money. All the other doors we will open for you. So why are you worried about cents and rands? I said to you, keep your doors closed. I don't want you to open any doors for me, but that's what I'm going to charge you. And he said, you must be crazy. You don't understand the system at all. Anyway, got in my car, felt quite disappointed with myself being so cheeky. But the next day they phoned to say that, you know, they've got the money and I can carry on. So that's how the party got the new logo and things happened.
So initially they brought you in as an ad man, yeah, to sort of modernize the national party, its logo. And
then they won the election smartly, with a lot of English voters came into the national party because it was a little bit broader, new logo, new forward together. So yeah, that's where it all started.
And so tell us about your meeting with P.W. Botha.
Well, that was, I always had this problem with the National Party, as you know, things cost money in marketing. If you go on television like this, you know, it costs money. And they always had a problem with, you know, they thought they were the government, that you used to do things for nothing. And so one day they called me, and I was actually in America on a business trip. They said, we've got the money that you've always wanted for a campaign, and we've got this new campaign for you to do. But in the meantime, I got seriously born again. Now, you must understand my history. My history is, I was the child of a missionary couple. I grew up in the mission field, and we are very, very poor. But later on, my father did a business in schooling, in education, and he sent us all to university, and that's how I became an ad man. Why did I tell you that?
Yeah, about P.W. Botha, your meeting.
Okay, and then they said to me that they got this incredible campaign. Here's the brief. We're going to do a three-party, three-room
tricameral parliament.
And this is the biggest idea in the world, and we're going to have a referendum about it. And we are briefing you as the agency. You must do it for us, and you've got 2 million rand to do it. Now, you had 2 million rand. Those days was like 200 million rand today. And they thought they would now knock me dead. So I went home. By these times, I was praying about this project, you know. I prayed about this project, and God said to me very clearly, now this is what you tell them. Not only will the three parliament be the worst idea that South Africa has ever seen, nobody's even going to remember it. And if you want to do anything in South African politics, you must bring the blacks into parliament. You must bring the blacks into the national life again. And so you must go there and you must actually tell them all the wrongs that they are doing. You know, all these casinos and things like that on the home, Bantustans or whatever you want to call those things. It was incredible. The war that they're fighting on the borders were from the devil, man. And he said, in the end, you must tell them that it's a very bad idea. Now, it was the 10th of January, 1982, when the message that they got was, why don't you open the National Party? Why don't you make it the National Party? With all people. National means national. And forget about this trichometrical parliament. It's going to be a bad idea. God says people will only not even remember it. And then the toughest part of the whole presentation was, in the end, I had to look PW in the eye. Now, that was the old Groot Crocodile, huh?
That's right.
And I don't know whether anybody's ever spoken to him like that. I had to look him in the eye and said, Mr. President, if you do not do what God has now told you to do, he will replace you. And that's like telling the president he's going to be fired. Well, the man was famous for the rockets that came out of his eyes. Mm. Anyway, the whole...
The finger wagging.
He didn't even wag a finger. He just looked at me. It was dead quiet in the cabinet room. The end of that story is they didn't listen to me. But they found later to say that, listen, the National Party is a huge ship. What I've said has turned them a little bit, but not completely. But I think from that day onward, there was something born in PW that changed him. Because actually, he did a lot of good that we really don't know so much about. He was actually the first guy that got Mandela to visit him in his office, put him out of jail to come and talk to him about getting him released.
But now we know the history and we fast forward. It didn't work. And as you prophesied, nobody actually remembers it. It was such a bad idea. P.W. Botha was ousted as president, and F.W. de Klerk came in.
But before that, something fantastic happened. This new South Africa, this country, has always been resonating deep in my heart, because I think God gives you a holy discontent. Everybody that's watching this television program has got a holy discontent. Something that God gave him that he should be doing something about. That's a godly instruction. Mine is the South Africa. I know that there's a destiny on this land. There's a redemption of calling on our land, and it's to be a light amongst nations. And the wonderful words that Bishop Tutu used in Rainbow Nation is a wonderful idea. Anyway, I was sitting one day and reading the Bible, and I knew exactly why I was sitting in the Natal South Coast. And the Lord said to me, I'll give you three words that will change South Africa forever. It'll change this whole land and the history of this country. But I'm going to tell you those three words, and now it was 1984 or something like that. But you're not allowed to say anybody, tell anybody about it. Just keep it to yourself, because I have first to anoint the ears of those who will hear. Now that was an incredible lesson, because you can speak to people, but if they are not anointed ears, you're actually speaking to closed ears. And this was a major issue. So for 6 years, I had to really be quiet about it. Until one day, when Ray McCauley was making a sermon. He was speaking in a sermon, and unexpectedly, and I've got it on video because I knew I had to keep it for posterity. He says, yes, Lord, I will do that. Yes, I do not understand
it. This is while he's preaching.
While he's preaching, on the stage. He says, yes, Lord, I will do it, and I don't understand it. I really don't understand it, but I'll do it. And he looked up and he says, it's Louis Wilsenach in church this morning. And I was sitting right in the back. And he called me forward and he says, the Lord says that he's going to open the office, the doors of the most important office in South Africa, and you're going to speak into it and it will change the land. And I thought, aha, he laid hands on me, prayed over me, and said, Louis, I really don't understand what I'm doing, but you must understand somehow. So I thought to myself, oh, the Lord is doing something. It's about time. And then PW was fired. Now, I don't know whether you know the story of how he was fired. He was very unexpectedly fired.
Yeah.
He really didn't expect to be fired, but he was.
Yeah, we remember that.
You remember that. Yeah. It was an incredible moment in history. And then by some strange thing, FW became the new president. Unexpectedly, he was never prepared for this role. And he decided to call me again, to hear me, because he really knew that God was speaking to me and that I had this passion for South Africa. So he sent a spy to Johannesburg from Cape Town to say, would you lunch with me? I've got a message for you. And when we lunched, always nice to have a nice lunch, he said to me, FW wants to know whether he can speak to you again, whether you can advise him again. I said, with the greatest pleasure. Cut a long story short, one day in my office, I was an office block across the road from Ellis Park, I picked up the phone and I said, may I speak to the president, please? Now, if I tell you the story today, it's very strange, because who can pick up a phone and say, I want to speak to the president? Mm. Strangely enough, they put me through to the president. I said, Mr. President FW, I want to see you in my office, but I want to see you by yourself. I don't want any of your other guys around you, your advisors. Right. I want you to see you alone. How's Wednesday morning? He said, Wednesday morning, I can do it. So the next day, the guys came, the police cleared the building. And on a Wednesday morning at a certain time, there was FW in my office. So I sat down, I said, FW, I have a message from God to you. God says that, but first he told me that he's been made president and it was unexpected and he really doesn't have an idea of which way he should go. And I said, well, this is what God told me. God told me that there's three words that will change the history of South Africa. And if I give you the three words and you take it to heart, then he will do a mighty work in South Africa. And the three words is the new South Africa. And the secret of the three words is nothing of the old South Africa can go into the new South Africa. So all the old baggage of this thing must be left behind and the new South Africa is a whole new idea. And he listened to me and he said, I've just come from other consultants. The other consultant says, I must be even stronger, mightier than PW was. And you say, this new South Africa, which means democracy. He says, but anyway, Louis, thank you. And I said, then I must tell you one thing. If God gives you an instruction, he always gives you a blessing with it. God never tells you to do something and he doesn't tell you what blessing it will bring to you. Let me tell you what the blessing will be. The blessing will be that the kings and the queens of the world will invite you to their palaces. So you will be one of the greatest statesmen of your time. The president of the United States is going to invite you and he's going to ask you to speak to the nation and he's going to take you to the Rose Garden and the Marine Band will play the stem. Now, it was a time when no South African leader could go
anywhere in the world.
Nowhere in the world. You went personas non grata. And the stem was not played anywhere in the world. So how can a man say that to me? I said, well, you will see it. You will stand there next to the president, and the Green Band will play this to him, and you will be a hero.
Now, Louis, fascinating stuff. We have to go for a break now, but when we come back, I want you to tell our viewers about the meeting that you had with F.W. de Klerk and the cabinet, how God used you there. And then we want to talk about the vision that God has given you for South Africa now, the Rainbow Nation, the curriculum, the schools, all of those things when we come back from the break. Don't go away. Welcome back to the program. I'm speaking to Louis Wilsenach, which is a fascinating discussion about Louis's involvement with the National Party, the former regime of this nation. He was an ad man. He was called in to help them to bring the National Party into the modern age. And he did that, but then had a lot, God use him to have a lot more influence in the party, with the political leaders, with the presidents, P.W. Botha and F.W. de Klerk. So in our last segment, we ended off with this meeting you had with F.W. de Klerk and you telling him about the new South Africa. Yeah. Now, you also had a vision of the flag, the old South African flag,
yeah,
and then the current flag,
yeah,
and then you saw a flag in the future. Yeah. Tell us about that.
Well, I have to start a little bit, backtrack a little bit.
Sure.
The one thing you must understand if God gives you a word is you can actually relax about it. You don't need to worry about the word. The word is God's word. And it'll do its work in the other person or in the nation, whatever it is. So I spoke that word with New South Africa to FW, and 3 days later he called me and he said, listen, I'm buying it. I think you're right. I want you to present it to my cabinet. Very important. So the first time FW as a president saw his whole cabinet was in the old Rathsal building in Pretoria Square. And the two of us were sitting right where the president was sitting. I mean, here this ad man is asked to sit right next to the president. And the president said to the cabinet, it's the first time I actually meet you as a cabinet, as a president. It's an historic event. And I want you not to listen to me today, but to listen to Louis. Louis, tell them. So I told them what's on my heart. And by that time, I had fleshed out the campaign a little bit. And I said, you know, this is the whole idea of the new South Africa. Everything of the old world will not fit into the new thing. And I was telling them why some of the old things had to fall by the way. And then the first guy jumped up, and it was Magnus Malang. That's the most impressive, tall Minister of Defense. And he actually said to the president, you better remove that man from that chair. You better quiet him now because he's talking the biggest nonsense in the world. And the president said to Mr. Malang, ta-ra-ta-ra-ta-ra, and sat him down. And the next guy jumped up, and the next guy jumped up, and the next guy jumped up. All the old conservative guys jumped up and said, silence that man, silence that man. And suddenly, Puk Botha jumped up with his hands in the air like that. And he said, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I've been waiting for this moment for 19 years. And from that moment, the youngsters jumped up and said, this is the vision that we can go with.
So for our viewers, benefit, Puk Botha was the former Minister of Foreign Affairs.
Yeah.
In the old National Party,
yeah,
government.
Yeah.
And so he jumped onto the vision.
When he said hallelujah, that whole concept was accepted. And the youngsters came on board. And now the new South Africa is the history. Right. So it was wonderful. But you know, the other thing about God's word is you mustn't try and be somebody that you're not. So I kept very quiet after that. I went into my quiet life again as an ad man, and I didn't try to be a strategic director for the president, which I wasn't called to do. I was called by God to give him that idea. And that idea made him famous. That he stood on the Rose Garden, the Marine band played the stem, and he was the Nobel Prize winner.
That's
so
right.
It's fantastic. Everything that God said he would do for him, he did for him. And that's 20 years ago now. Now, in the meantime, I would come out of an advertising world, and corporates are amazing things. I think the way they invest into the top people is incredible. The way they invest into new products is incredible. The research they do is incredible. And I had a lot of friends in the church world. And then I look at the church and I say, the church has got a vision. And the pastor is not spending, investing money in his leadership. And I said to the Lord, why don't you give me an opportunity to work with churches and I'll get out of advertising, because I've learned so much about advertising. I can't sell any more Jeeps. How many more knickknacks can people eat, you know?
That's right.
And I need to do this work with the church. So for the next 10 years, I worked with churches. But underneath it all, I had an idea. And God, and I said to myself, I better get an artist to paint this picture. And it's a picture of three flags. The old South African flag, all tattered. And then the new South African flag, and it was really also tattered. And then there's a flag, a godly flag. And what that visual said to me is that although the old South Africa was a dreadful place and it went to pieces, the new South Africa, so to speak, is also going to go all flooded, and as we are experiencing it today. Our municipalities are not working. Our schools don't work. Nothing works. There's corruption. And we are desperate. That flag broken up like that is really, it's happening today. And that flag is over our country today. But this country has a destiny. God has a plan for every nation. If it was the Greeks or the Romans or the Americans or the Empire State, God has a plan for everybody. And God has a magnificent plan for South Africa. It's many, many prophecies has been spoken over South Africa. But the main prophecy is that South Africa will become a light amongst nations. And that is such an incredible idea, that to think that in this world that we live today, people will look at us and say, wow, look at that land. We're 144 out of 150 schools today, but we are going to push right up to the top. Corruption, we're number one with corruption. It's going to go right down. We're going to become a light amongst nations, because that's God's calling for this land.
It's God's destiny for South Africa.
That's God's destiny for South Africa. And He will have His way. There's no way that you can stand in God's way. If He wants to have a son born at a certain day, His son will be born. He will choose a Mary. He will choose a Louis to speak. He will choose an Errol to do his thing. This is a very important program. This program must go out to South Africa and tell them, the listeners, that we should be watchmen on the wall.
Right.
It's very important. It's an incredible job. It's underrated. So you're doing a marvelous job, and I'm very, very glad you're doing it. If there's one program that's at least a watchman on the wall.
So you're talking about this destiny and plan that God has for South Africa. Mm-hmm. Now, you've been involved with in the old South Africa, and you see the way it went.
Yeah.
You've been involved in the new South Africa in 20 years. You see the flag is lying in tatters.
Absolutely.
Because of the corruption, because of the incompetence, our health sector, our education is
sure.
In crisis, right. All kinds of things. Mm. So many people are despondent in South Africa. There's black, white, colored, Indian. People are despondent because there's no hope. They don't see a future. There's no leadership. And you saying that God hasn't forgotten South Africa.
You.
God has spoken over this nation.
You.
And we still have a great destiny.
You.
And that destiny is going to come to pass.
It must. And He will call you again. He will call whoever He wants to. And for the last 10 years, I've been spending all my life in doing children's ministry. Not actually children's ministry. The Lord's giving me an idea that a child is the most important thing in the world.
So you're saying that what God is saying to you is that we must impact the young generation South Africa.
Absolutely.
Begin to speak destiny into their lives, begin to impact their lives, because the new South Africa is in the hearts of our young people.
The future, our future is in kids. That's where the future is, in children. These children that we have today, they will be the lights of the world.
So education then becomes critical, not only education, reading, writing, and arithmetic, but speaking destiny into their lives, speaking values into their lives. The fatherless generation, that issue that is plaguing South Africa, how do we overcome that?
Well, the father thing is ginormous, because 70% of our children grow up without a father in their house. And the father is the rock of a house. It's the basis of a house. The father is a representative of God.
That's right.
He should be in the house directing his family. They're missing. So we have to not have a bigger police force. We have to be a father to every other boy we see in the world. If I stop at the service station to put petrol in, then I'm going to be a father to that guy who puts petrol into my car for the next 3 minutes. I'm going to be his dad. And so we have to break up our lives and lie like that. When we meet a young person or a young man, we must be his father for a little bit, even if it's 3 seconds.
Do you think there should be a mind shift in the church about this issue, in that the church needs to start realizing that God has given us a mandate to change this nation? And the way we're going to change that is not perhaps just preaching in churches every Sunday, but beginning to get out of the churches, out of the pews, and beginning to father young men and young women who are fatherless and begin to impact and speak destiny into their lives. Is that what you're saying, Louis?
Absolutely, absolutely. We are all little parts of Jesus on earth. And if you are at a store and you at the mall and you're paying for the groceries you just bought, you are with a lady for about 33 seconds, maybe a minute. In that minute, you can plant in her some hope. You've just spoken beautiful words over one of your cameramen. And that gave him just the audacity to be a greater cameraman than he was 5 minutes ago. And that little moment that you have with this lady at the mall, at the cashier, you can actually be Jesus in the kind of, you can mother her, you can give her hope. And when you walk away from her, she's got something in her that says, ooh, there's hope. And that's the destiny.
So Louis, what is God saying to you now? What is your burning passion, vision for South Africa to bring this vision to pass? What are you doing? What do you want to do? And then what is your message to the Church of Jesus Christ out there?
Okay. Well, God always works in mysterious ways. I wrote a book. It's called Alieva. It's a funny thing to do, write a book about yourself. And I ashamedly wrote this book about myself because I had a very interesting life. I did some very interesting things. And the last paragraph of this book is actually a very beautiful paragraph. And I say that, you know, I want people to write a book about your life. Everybody should write a book about their lives because there's some great moment in a person's life that you should share. And you should celebrate your life. You should celebrate yourself. You know, God said, love others like you love yourself.
That's right. You can't
love another person if you haven't loved yourself first. You must love this oak first. And people don't love themselves anymore. That's why they're so hard on each other, because they don't love this person. So the last paragraph of my book says, I want you to look into a mirror. I want you to look into that mirror until you see Jesus in it. Because there's a little bit of him in every one of us.
That's right.
And you must look at that mirror, whoever you are out there. You must look at it and discover that there's a little bit of Jesus in you. And when you discover that, you will never be the same again.
Amen.
And that's, you know, that's the message to the churches out there. Mm. Guys, really, we have to... It's not around being blessed or prosperous or driving a new BMW or what it is. It's about being Jesus everywhere. He was such an ordinary man. I mean, he invited people to a dinner and nobody came. He said, go out to the streets and get everybody in. He was an ordinary man. He said, you in the tree there, come down. And that's all we need to be. Little Jesus everywhere, in every moment of our life.
Amen. Now Louis, so your burning passion now as an ex-ad man is to visit and meet with top business people, influential leaders in all sectors of society, and share this vision that God has given you, that there is this great hope, there's this great vision, there's this great destiny for South Africa. Yeah. Even though we're facing real challenges, you know,
absolutely.
But God still has spoken over this nation,
yeah.
And he's got a great plan for South Africa.
Yeah.
And will you say then that the church is responsible for bringing that new South Africa to pass?
The church is us, people. And I really believe that every born-again person in this country, if he gets the vision that, in the first place, understand that we will be a light amongst nations.
That's right.
That will be you in your own way will be a light amongst nations. You in your company, you at the service station, you in your most private moments must be a light amongst nations. It's our job, and it must be right down to grassroots. And that's why with this, I've been quiet for 20 years. For 20 years, I've not been on any program. And here I am sitting on the wall with you. And it's just because a pastor was woken up one morning by the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit said to this pastor, who I don't even know, that don't forget the rainbow idea. Don't let the rainbow fade was actually the Holy Spirit's words. Don't let the rainbow fade. 3 days later, he read my book because his son-in-law bought it. Now, this is how this book works. This is an amazing book. People read this book and they're inspired. And I didn't know that. And for years, it wasn't. And then he looked at that picture of the three flags. And he said, wow, there's a rainbow on that flag. There's a dove of the Holy Spirit on that flag. Maybe this is the man I should speak to. And then he called me and he met me and he said, listen, the rainbow idea is an idea that you have to pursue. And I said, okay. Called a group of very important pastors together, shared the idea with them, they prayed about it, and they were very excited. And then for a long time I let it go a little bit because I was very busy with the children. And then a friend of mine took me for a meal, and in the middle of the meal he said to me, that passion that God has placed in your heart about our rainbow nation, about the new South Africa, you have to pursue it with everything you got. And if you need anything, I will be there for you.
And that's what you're doing now.
And that's what I'm doing now. Yeah. And what is on my heart now is just to go to the most prominent leaders of the country, whether you're in education or a church or a corporate. I know that this thing cannot be done by the church per se, by the organized church. This must happen in companies, it must happen in departments, it must happen in schools, it must happen in principals' offices, it must happen everywhere. And I'm meeting with one by one the most prominent people that I can think of. And if there's anybody out there that's listening to me tonight and you want to speak to me, please call me, because I want to just broaden this message. Sow the seed. This South Africa, there's a destiny on us. We will be a
light of the nation.
Amen.
A light of the nation.
Amen.
Louis, it was fascinating speaking to you. You're a man of passion and destiny. I can see that on you. And we want people to catch the fire, to catch your passion.
The Spirit must jump in them.
Absolutely. And we're asking Christians out there, follow Louis' example and speak life into this nation, not death. Even though we see all the challenges, do not speak those challenges. Do
Amen.
Not speak the problems that we face, but rather the destiny and the plan of God. So if we can keep on saying and praying and speaking that South Africa is a light to the nations, South Africa is and will be a light to the nations,
sure.
Because God has mandated this nation to be a light to other nations in Jesus' name. So Louis, great to speak to you. Fascinating.
Can I end with a prophetic word?
Yes.
We sing a song all the years that the nations of this world, they will become the kingdoms of our God. South Africa will be the first kingdom of our God in the world.
Amen.
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 Wonderful.
Speaking to Judith Sephuma, one of the leading Christian artists in South Africa. Judith does jazz, R&B, and blues, and gospel, and all kinds of things. Yeah. Welcome to the studio, Judith, and thank you for joining us. I'm excited about your new album, One Word. Tell us a little bit about it, what inspired it, some of the highlights.
Well, thank you for having me on the show, and the album, One Word, it is inspired by curiosity. I was just curious, you know, to see what will my sixth album be after having released a gospel album, because I took a break for about, it's 4 years now since my last jazz album. And in that 4 years, having recorded the experience live in concert, it was quite a bit of a, you know, a break. So coming back into jazz, everything that I was writing actually was just going gospel. Everything was about God, God, God. And I decided, you know, I'm going to just stop. and then write my jazz album because my fans kept on asking about it. And so I went into the studio, I started writing, and then I called friends of mine and said, listen, this is what I'm doing, send me songs, and they did that. And then we went in, we recorded a beautiful album. It's got songs that are written in Lingala. Lingala is, Lingala is from Congo. And I'm also singing in Portuguese. But also, I still sing in Sepedi, which is my home language, and in Zulu, and obviously English. So I kind of like tried to have everything in one. And we managed to have that and to balance it out nicely.
So what is the standout song on One Word?
We've got quite a few because I know Metro FM, like the radio station Metro FM, they've picked about 5 songs that they're playing now. And different radio stations have picked different songs on the album. So we've got quite almost every song on the album is being played. I just don't know yet because it's been a month since it's been out. I don't know yet which one is standing out. But most of the radio stations, they're loving Utando, which is track number 2. Joy, we released Joy as a single. And they're loving Belinda as well. Belinda is in Congo. It's in Lingala, and it's speaking about this woman. People always ask me, who's Belinda? You know, but Belinda talks about this woman who is just, she's a mother. She's a beautiful mother who's been away from home for a long time. And he's saying, you've been gone for so long. If you can just send me a picture of yours so I can remember what you look like. And then he starts praising her beauty in the song. So that's one of the songs. And I have a song as well. It's called Try. It's recorded with a wonderful guy from Zimbabwe. He's living he lives in South Africa. He's a raga rapper. It's reggae, and he comes in and he does this rap on the song. It's also people love it, you know. So it's quite a lovable album.
Now, the album previous to this was a gospel album. Tell us a little bit about that album.
Oh, no, that album, I think it's going to be around for a very, very long time. And, you know, a friend of mine, my friend, very good friend of mine, me and Neville have known each other for so many years, since way before I even released A Cry, Smiling a Dance. And he wrote me about 4 songs. Actually, he sent me, I think, 7 songs. And of those 7 songs, we took 4. That are on the Experience Live in Concert. And then I recorded some hymns as well.
And what is that album called?
It's called The Experience Live in Concert.
Okay.
It's a double CD and a DVD.
Okay.
Yes, and we recorded it live with 9 singers, 6 musicians at the Lyric Theatre in Johannesburg. And that was some time ago, I don't know, 2000 and something, 12 something,
couple 13. Of years ago.
Yeah, something like that. Ago. Yeah.
But A Cry, A Smile, A Dance is still your most popular
album.
Yeah,
it is. It still is.
Your greatest hits on
it. It still has my greatest hits. That entire album got airplay.
Mm.
That whole album, every one of those songs was on radio. And it's now in excess of 220,000, I think. It's beautiful. Whenever I perform A Cry, A Smile, and Dance, that particular song, we don't want to stop because it's such a beautiful, beautiful song to perform live.
Yeah, I know. I've seen you in concerts, and when you come onto the stage, that's the first song people want you to sing.
Yeah, and you know, it's amazing because in Cape Town, when I get on stage, they always want, are you still there first? So I get up, the minute I start saying, you're like a mystery, they go, woo! They go really crazy for that song. Yeah, another friend of mine wrote me that song as well. He's a doctor.
And as far as live performances are concerned, are you still doing concerts all over the world, South Africa?
Yeah, a lot. Live performing is my life. I love it. It makes me excited about being a singer, being an artist. You know, because I think that's where I become more creative. You know, I become my best, and I think that's where I discover me all over again, because you know, I believe that as a singer, you have to be able to know your strengths and your weaknesses, and you have to know how far you can push yourself. So I'm able to do that when I'm on stage. I love being on stage. I go mad on stage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it's the interaction with the people.
It's that intimacy.
Very different to a studio.
And the fact that I'm gonna go out there and really get to hear what people are gonna. It's good to know that people know your songs. And if they don't know my songs, I have a very good way of teaching people my songs and they'll never forget it. And they'll go look for the album and get it. And when they come back again for the second show, I make them remember. And that's why when we do shows, I always stick to the same venues for a couple of times, because I know that we get more, it's important to always get new audiences, new fans. So if I did a show and everybody knew me, they knew my songs, I'd be worried. I want to get to a show, and I always ask my fans that who is here for the first time? And they will, you'll see them, they'll raise their hands and they'll be the ones standing up and dancing more than the other. You know, because they're coming, they're just discovering who Judith is. And that is the best part of being an artist.
That's right.
When you can get that, you know, those new audiences. If I'll go anywhere and someone says, I don't know who you are, it excites me, because now I feel like, okay, now I really have to keep working hard. You know, it does. That's why I always say you must never stop learning as a person. You must never stop and get to a point where you're feeling like, I am the Judith. Yeah, I can sing. I can sing better than that. It must never, ever get to that point. And I think that's one thing I've always prayed for, you know, for God to really humble me where that is concerned, to say, keep me on my ground. I must always know that I have to work hard. I must continuously be working hard. I must continuously be curious about my gift. It's a gift.
It's a gift from God. So where's Judith Sephuma's relationship with the Lord right now?
Oh, man. He's messing me up. He messes me up all the time, you know, and he reveals himself in more ways than one, either with my family, with my children, in my work, you know, in accidents that I will have, you know, because I survived a very bad car accident a couple of months ago, where, I mean, I was even talking about that today and saying in that accident, I could have died. But, you know, I remember my manager said that in that car, she felt like someone was holding her like this. She was sleeping on a sponge while the car was rolling about 6 or 7 times. And it went on to the other side of the road facing oncoming cars, oncoming traffic, and nothing happened to us. We got out of that car with no scratch, only because I had a dream that I was reciting Psalm 91 in that dream, and I was underwater and the car was rolling in the water. When I woke up, we were actually rolling, and I started shouting the name of Jesus. That's all I did. I just said, Jesus. And I heard people saying, where the car stopped, someone said, it's going to explode. It's going to explode. And imagine you're in the car and they are panicking. I said, oh, you better call that name right. I screamed. I said, call Jesus. And I started praying and I say, you know what? That fire will not happen in Jesus' name. That fire will go down. And the fire went down. It is amazing how God wants us to know him.
Amen.
But we have to be willing to know him. We have to be there where he wants us to be. He wants us. He's very, very selfish with his children, you know, because he knows the kind of gift we have, what we carry, you know, and what we can do with the power that we have, that he has given us. We are made in his image and in his likeness. So the same power that he possesses, we have. Mm-hmm. So we just have to know that's the kind of power we have. You know, like whatever is happening in South Africa right now, we've got the power to change it all.
Yes, we have.
Yeah, we've got the power to change it all.
And it seems like wherever you go, whatever you do, amidst all the, you know, the fans and the music concerts and everything, presence of God is there.
It is always there.
You feel it all the time.
I cannot even, when I'm doing my jazz concerts, my band knows you are either a lover of God or you are not. When you're with us, if you are not, you will leave there being a lover of Christ. And whenever we don't go on stage without praying. And when we get off stage, we always thank God. And when we are on stage, even in the middle of a song, when I feel I'm in joy, the band is really at the climax. I'm like, oh, Jesus, thank you, Lord. That's what we do. You know, and that's what God wants. You don't have to be saying too many words. Just say thank you. Just acknowledge him when you know, at that point, when you sense that he is right there with you.
Amen.
In my music, in the jazz music, he is there. I always call my music inspirational, because my music, you know, has healed people, jazz as it is. I've had people call me with a crying smile and a dance and saying, I was divorcing my wife and then I heard this song. There's one woman who said, I was suicidal and then I heard this song. And at that point, I was not even... I didn't really know God the way I know him now. And that got me curious to say, who is this God? I want to know him because he does great things. Yes, he does great things. So all of that, the music, my music it heals people, and I pray that it continues to heal people, and it must heal me all the time as well.
Yeah. No, God, Judith, God's given you an extraordinary gift. You're a blessing to this nation. People love you wherever I go. Judith Sephuma, we tried to get you for our Christmas concert, but you were so busy. And we're going to keep on trying to get you the next time.
It'll happen.
But, you know, the thing I admire about you the most is whenever you perform, whether it's jazz, R&B, whatever the circumstances, you always find time to give God praise and glory in your music, in your performances. You remind me of Jonathan Butler, you know, another great Christian artist that South Africa produced. So we thank you for your music. We wish you well with One Word and every other CD album that you put out there, your travels around the world, your performances here in South Africa. May God use you through the gift he's given you. And we bless you. Thank you again for coming into the studio and speaking to us.
Thank you for having me. Thank you so much.
That's our program for tonight. Thank you for joining us. Please visit our website at familypolicyinstitute.com and subscribe to my weekly newsletter. This is my primary method of communicating with you, so please subscribe today. If you have any comments or suggestions for the show, please write to us at info@familypolicyinstitute.com. We value your comments and your input. Remember, the latest edition of Joy Magazine is available in retail stores right around the country. Please remember to get your copy. Thank you once again for joining us. God bless you, and remember to keep standing.